please the court?
Yes.
Counsel? Ladies and gentlemen, respond to Mr. Adams' closing. Defendant's fear is not reasonable. Things Mr. Adams raised, when you talk about it, this, he's claiming that he gets the gun, the defendant, because he's going to protect Deb. If you use common sense, okay, he's so scared that Jason's after Deb, they keep going back to Keith Reiser's place. Remember how many times they went there? 3 or 4 times that night? Why is that important? Deb Ewing told you, that's where Jason would hang out. He would stay there. So apparently they're so scared of Jason that he just keeps going back there, but now he has a gun, so he's maybe not as scared. But the other thing is, he sends her into a public place to go get the bullets. And then what does he do in the morning hours? The defendant, he drops her off at his place. The place that he's so scared that she's going to be there because Jason is going to find her. But ask yourself, what evidence in this case ever came in that Jason knew where the defendant lived? None. So not only the defendant drops her off, Deb Ewing at his place with Sammy and Caleb, he takes this loaded gun with him. He doesn't leave it with Deb if she needs to protect herself. Makes no sense. Mr. Adams said, well, wait a minute. It's Caleb, really. He says, I'm not trying to blame people. Sure sounded like he's blaming Caleb because Caleb puts in a piece of paper because the defendant doesn't have the key to the security door. He puts it in there. But think about this. Ask yourselves this. What time did Caleb and Sammy leave that apartment? They got in an argument and they left. Defendant's not home yet. He gets home after that. And guess what he didn't do? So scared of everybody that night, he gets there, he has to go through that security door. Oh, wow, there's a piece of paper in here. Who would put that there? I'm going to take this out because I don't want somebody to come up into my place. That's why he wasn't expecting anybody to buzz him in. He knew that was in the security door. It was convenient for the defendant as well. He didn't take it out because if he wanted to leave, he didn't have to buzz people. Deb told you, when the defendant was sitting on the couch, he didn't seem scared or terrified. I think she said terrified was her word. So you have to use your recollection on that. And if he's so scared, ask yourselves, folks, if he's so scared of Corey and Jason that he feared for Deb's life or for his life, why does he call the police? We know he can do that. When he had the eviction question, you want Corey out of there, and no problem calling the police there. That's what a reasonable person would do. Look at the text messages. They want you to believe he just terrified Corey Mays. The guy that he gave $600 to. The guy that he gives a key to that he claims has a gun. And what? The whole claim Corey Mays has a gun and he's living with him, and then Corey Mays is going to leave the apartment without the gun if the gun ever existed. Makes no sense. Look at the text messages. Stacy's at the 77. You have these take back, the green or Larry's phone, the defendant's phone, sending this number associated with Corey's phone. I need my key. Makes sense. Defendant wants his key because he still has that security key he might get back. No police. So terrified of this Corey Mays, this bad guy they want to keep throwing at the mall shoot. Just to get a Prohaska set. He wasn't a witness in the case. He wasn't a shooter. They want to make it sound like Corey's bad. What's Corey's response? Or at least the phone that Corey Mays had. I'm about to call them and make a report about my phone because it was in your house when it got stolen. So they really want you to believe that Corey Mays is going to want to go over and kill or harm the defendant over a phone? When he gave him $600, just go get a new phone. Makes no sense. Reasonable person. Defendant's not required to act with perfect judgment, Mr. Adams said. That's true. He's not. But he's required to act with care and caution. A reasonable person would have used under the circumstances which existed at that time. He's sitting on a couch. Clearly, he can't see that door. We know that we have the Stacy's at 65. want to go back in. And that's what Caleb said. He actually wanted to, well, now it's Caleb's fault to try to get his bikes out of the defendant's garage. Somehow he's stealing his own bikes. Because he wanted to avoid a situation, which if he could have, would have been great. But he couldn't. Clear? The defendant knew Sammy's coming back. There's no dispute. He told Investigator Prohaska that. You have knocking on the door. Ask yourself this. Care and caution, a reasonable person would say. Mr. Adams says, what if you have knocking on the door? If you're on the other side, you're Sammy. What would a reasonable person do if you don't hear anybody inside? You had permission to be there because you had the key. You would unlock the lock. What would a reasonable person do if you're inside an apartment and at 4 a.m.? He'd say, who's there? Right? Who's there? That's a good indication you might find out who's on the other side. What if it's another tenant that had the wrong door? Who's there if a reasonable person responds? Viewpoint of a reasonable person, jury. You're not to consider the danger, apparent danger, from the viewpoint, or you are, from the viewpoint of a reasonable person under the circumstances. Mr. Adams, wait a minute. All three of these people were in a stressful situation. Deb Ewing, the defendant, and Caleb. Caleb certainly was, after he watched his girlfriend's brains get blown out. Deb Ewing, sleeping, maybe not quite as stressful. They wouldn't be believe the defendant is this terrible, stressful situation. Remember what he told Investigator Prohaska? He's a retired Marine. Seriously? A Marine. You don't think they have any type of boot camp? You don't think somebody in the Marines is trained maybe to handle stressful situations? You think some people in the military might actually encounter those? If Corey Mays, we want you to believe that somebody's going to be breaking into your house or in his apartment, the defendant's apartment. If this is some intruder that's going to do harm, you really think the intruder's going to, hey, I'm here to hurt you, just letting you know. Make any sense. Absolutely not. Before he had a key, he didn't have to knock it off. He just would unlock the lock, if that was his intent. The door was being unlocked by a person who was provided the key. No threats were being made. No indication the person had a weapon on the other side. And there was no response. So Sammy did what a reasonable person would do. She used the key. Yeah, and Mr. Adams is right. They could have called. Yeah, they could have called the phone, but they didn't. The point is, they knocked. They knocked to let them know there. I mean, really, Sammy could have just used the key. She didn't have to knock at all. She didn't want to, but she was being polite. She knocked. And there was no response. It's 4 a.m. Makes sense. She's going to say, okay, apparently they're sleeping. She's going to go in. Was the defendant justified? This goes back to what we already talked about. Clearly not. It's not a standard as what the defendant, Mr. Adams, kept saying. Well, the defendant was scared. He was scared. Well, being paranoid doesn't mean you're scared. Putting knives in the door doesn't mean you're scared necessarily. You'd be paranoid as well. But it's not a subjective standard. It's not just what's in the defendant's head, but what a reasonable person in these situations. And all five of these the state approved, but we only have to prove one of them. Again, you don't get to, even if you're in your own house, somebody knocks on your door, Mr. Adams says, what are you supposed to do? Wait till they come in? Well, you could say, who's there? That would be a start. If you're not hearing there, you do have a phone, you could call the police, or you have the wall on State Exhibit 65. He could have stayed in this area of hand protection. He could stay behind the wall to see what was going to happen, see who's there. The person that had the loaded gun was the defendant. But that's just under alternative course of action. Even if you think, well, I don't know if he has to do that. Clearly, the defendant didn't have reasonable grounds to believe. There's no threats being made, no door being kicked in. It's just unreasonable. A couple more moments. Mr. Adams said, this is what the defendant claimed. The defendant claimed when he's interviewed by Investigator Prohaska that he fired the first shot and the locks kept moving, or the door kept turning. It makes no sense, folks. Saying he's not turning that lock once you've got her head blasted. She's on the ground with a hole in her head, and Caleb's on the ground with her. That just makes no sense. What happened is Sammy unlocks the door. She's trying to, then she puts the key in her pocket, going to turn the knob, and that's when the defendant blasts through. And then the question is, well, why didn't, Mr. Adams said, well, why didn't he fire the other two shots if he meant to kill somebody? Well, first of all, we don't have to prove he had to kill anybody. But see, the defendant used the element of surprise. He knew there was somebody right behind that door before he blasted that first shot. Because he didn't say anything. So Sammy on the other side of the door had no idea the defendant was standing here with State Exhibit 4 pointed right toward that door. And he fired that first shot. Now, even though he didn't know it was Sammy, whoever was on the other side of the door, now they know that, and he doesn't know their position anymore. So he fires two rounds off to the side and then tells them to get away from my door. Mr. Adams would say, well, why did the defendant do this? And he's right. The state doesn't have to prove the why. I mean, there could be various reasons. The why is not an element. We talked about this in jury selection. The state only has to prove the four elements. It could be various reasons. The defendant said he was sick and tired of it. The defendant had a gun. He had it loaded. And if they were going to bring the situation to him, he was going to take care of it. Could be that. There could be other reasons. Many. But that's one of the things we're asking at jury selection is don't hold the state to some standard that we don't have to. We have to prove the elements beyond a reasonable doubt. And when he fired those, he got the two shots. Now I'll just actually wait on that one second. Mr. Adams said, well, state made a big deal to get two on a handgun instead of a rifle. What's the big deal? It's a big handgun. It's not as easy to conceal, but you can conceal this handgun a lot easier than you can conceal a rifle. The defendant was carrying that around with him all night after he bought it, or was at least in his possession nearby. But it comes down to really this case is clearly he's not justified. So then Mr. Adams said, okay, if it's not justification, it's reckless. We have reckless conduct here, not malice aforethought. So is it a manslaughter? Is it murder second? You got an instruction on reckless. So recklessness is willful. It is not intentional in the sense that harm is intended to result. So if you have reckless, you would have to go back there and believe the defendant never meant to harm anybody. Not manslaughter when the defendant intended the result. You have the definition of malice aforethought. Fixed purpose of design to do physical harm. Common sense, folks. Heard the knocking, he didn't ask who's there. He walked over to that door. And when you think about it, he walked over to that door with his gun without saying anything. This isn't a luck shot, folks. You look at State Exhibit 66. We got two off to the side there. What that shows is that's after the defendant now caught them off telling him to leave. He knows how to fire warning shots off to the side. Because that's what he did. He knows the difference. He fired those to the side. But when he fired that shot through the door, he meant business. He had a fixed purpose or design to do physical harm. He had mental support, though. This, ladies and gentlemen, Stacy did at 31, is reckless. You fire through the wall, and it ricochets, it goes through another apartment. When you were trying to, you shoot off to the side and hurt somebody. No harm was intended, but that's what happened. It was, you know, a situation where you never meant harm. That's reckless. Shooting through Exhibit 29, State Exhibit 3. When you walk over to a door, you hear knocking. And when you take this 44 and you take this gun and you point it toward that door, you pull back that hammer, you pull that trigger when you see the door actually turning, the doorknob, not say a word, and then you blast the shot off, you're doing some harm. You have a fixed purpose or design to do harm. What he was doing, that's mental support. The state has proved beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant is guilty of murder in the second degree. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hammerin.